There's a lot to think about when planning to prepare your Thanksgiving turkey. And this year, things may be a little different. Many of you may be forced to having to cook your own Thanksgiving turkey. Maybe you might not be with family for the first time in a while. Things are a little weird this year. So if you're a newbie, a beginner, I've got plenty of resources in my holiday plan of attack to cover all this stuff. But today, I just wanted to give a recap of sort of my guide, the things that I think about and consider and plan for when I'm planning to make a Thanksgiving turkey, broken down into 12 simple steps. So let's just jump right into it. The first step you need to consider is sourcing your bird. And that's really gonna consist of three things to consider. First is gonna be, are you gonna get fresh or frozen? Frozen does not necessarily mean it's bad at all. You can get good quality turkeys that are frozen. In fact, a lot of places, they have to sort of freeze them in order to transport so many turkeys around the same time to make sure everybody gets them. But you can also get fresh turkeys, especially if you have a butcher nearby. Maybe you can order one from him. Or now online, there's all sorts of resources to get a fresh turkey delivered. I prefer fresh because that means you don't have to thaw it. But if you do have a frozen bird, you gotta know that there's at least a day for every 4 pounds of meat that is frozen. So if you've got yourself like an 18 pound bird, you gotta give it a good week of defrosting before you even think about cooking it. So these are important things to think about ahead of time. The second thing is, what kind of bird are you gonna get? Are you gonna get a conventional bird? Are you gonna get like a free range organic turkey? Or are you gonna go with like a really high end heritage bird? I usually stay away from the conventional stuff. They load it with water. It's not good quality meat. It's really best to kind of get a level up from conventional at least. And my kind of go-to is a free range organic turkey. Heritage is good. It can be a little bit gamey. It could be a little bit tougher, but I don't think you can go wrong with free range and organic. The final aspect of sourcing is choosing the right size. A general rule of thumb is about 1 pound of meat per person. I think if you want leftovers, plenty of leftovers, you can go 1.5 pounds per person. If you have a large gathering, I wouldn't recommend going over 18 pounds. I would recommend in that case getting 2 smaller 10 to 12 pound birds. Over 18, you run the risk of the birds getting a little tough. They're a little bit harder to cook evenly. Smaller birds, they're easier to manage. They're usually more tender. They're easier to cook. Getting like a 22, 26, they even sell 28 pound birds. It's just, it's gonna cause problems more often than not. So a smaller bird is usually the way to go. So now that you've got your bird sourced, we have to talk about choosing the right method of cooking. It comes down to a few variables that you need to think about. One is the desired flavor you want. The other is what kind of gear you do have or you don't have. How big your oven is. How much food are you cooking? How many people are you cooking for? All of these things are gonna determine what method you choose to cook your bird. A whole bird is straightforward. It's simple. It's recognizable to everybody. It's kind of what everybody wants. The cons to it is that it kind of takes a long time to cook. It takes up your oven for a large part of the day. However, it yields that more conventional look that everyone's going for, and maybe that's what you want. You could do a butterfly turkey where you flatten the bird out and it cooks in more than half the time, and it usually cooks a lot more even. However, you lose that whole bird aesthetic that some people really want. Smoked turkey is a really popular way to do it. It's a great technique. Gets the turkey completely out of the kitchen, so it frees up the oven for all the other things. The one thing about that is that the flavor everybody is kind of hoping for. As great as smoked turkey is, some people are expecting something with like a little bit more neutral flavor for their Thanksgiving turkey. So it's just a matter of making sure that's the kind of thing people are into. Fried turkeys, I imagine, are fantastic, but it's dangerous. It requires a lot of equipment, specialized equipment. It's just not something that I recommend a newbie try. It's not something I really recommend an experienced cook to try, let alone, but you do you. And sous vide is actually the method that me and my brother use to cook our turkeys. It's another way of getting the turkey out of the oven, out of the kitchen, and freeing up time and space for other things. We usually make these in the basement. We got big plastic bins. Vacuum seal the legs separate from the breast. You cook the legs overnight in the water bath. You cook the breast the morning of. They hold in the water bath and they're perfectly cooked until we take them out and brown the skin in the oven last minute. It's hassle-free, very easy to do. However, the skin doesn't kind of get as crisp as it would if you dry roast it in the oven. There's just not enough time for moisture to escape and dry out the skin. So you do get that little rubberiness that isn't always ideal, but again, it's all a give and a take. Our kitchen is smaller, so it's less ideal to have a big bird cooking for 4 hours in the oven the day of Thanksgiving. We don't need to present the whole bird. We've kind of gotten over that. So we just go for a dissected bird cooked perfectly and presented to the table, carved. So once you've got the method down, we've got to start to think about prepping it. And the third thing I want to talk about is the wet brine versus the dry brine. A brine is basically a method of adding moisture and seasoning into lean cuts of meat. You're essentially adding moisture laced with salt by soaking a piece of meat in that salty solution, and that turkey is reabsorbing that salty solution through osmosis. The bird's juices get expelled out into that water bath and then reabsorbed with that salt seasoning the bird throughout. Wet brines, however, cause a little issue for me. It requires a big tub filled with water that's contaminated with turkey juice, and you need a place to put it that's cold enough that it doesn't spoil the turkey. So in the Northeast, you could kind of leave it outside when it's below 40 degrees, and you can make sure it's sealed and protected and use the outdoors like a walk-in. But not everyone in America can do that. A lot of places don't get below 40 degrees. A lot of people don't have a second refrigerator to put a huge tub of a turkey in as well. It also doesn't really aid in the skin getting crisp at all because it's just reintroducing more moisture to it. Dry brine works the same way by coating the turkey fully with salt and then letting that sit in a refrigerator overnight and allowing the process to do its thing. And it works by the salt pulling moisture to the surface of the turkey where it blends with the salt, absorbs it, and then gets reabsorbed back into the turkey with all of that salty flavor, seasoning the turkey throughout. It breaks down the fibers of the meat, tenderizing it, but it has the added benefit of drying out the skin, which is gonna allow us to get really great color and a great texture in the skin once we cook it. You'll still need to store it in the refrigerator, but it's just a much easier way to store it than in a huge tub. Number four is do not trust the legs. I know everybody shows trussing the legs and making it all look beautiful with butchered knots and whatnot. There's no need to do this. The legs and the breast cook differently. The legs need a lot more time in the oven. They need to hit about a 180 degree internal temperature, where the breasts need a 155 to 165 degree internal temperature to be nice and juicy and cooked. So by letting the legs hang without trussing, you're allowing more heat to rotate around the bird. That skin that usually gets rubbery from the trussing now has room to breathe and get brown. And the leg has more heat hitting it to allow it to cook faster. So by the time the breasts hit about 155 to 160, the legs are gonna be closer to 180, 190, which is gonna make them more tender. This idea that trussing helps make the bird cook evenly is nonsense. Don't listen to it, don't fuss with it. I promise you it's gonna come out better if you do not truss. Number five is keeping the flavor simple. KISS is an acronym I love. Stands for keep it simple, stupid. When in doubt, follow that. And for me, I just go simple with salt and olive oil and butter, keeping it in those flavors. I really just want that golden brown classic turkey look. I don't want any herbs that might get burnt or charred or run off the sides, creating weird color. I just want golden brown turkey all around that's seasoned from the brine throughout, and then all delicious flavors of Thanksgiving I can put in the gravy that I then pour on top. But I want to keep things simple with the flavors and focus on cooking the bird perfectly. My number six is do not stuff the turkey. Stuffing the turkey cuts off airflow to the interior of the turkey. It's essentially making the stuffing the center point of the meat because it's instantly contaminated the moment you put it in there, which is gonna force the turkey to cook from the outside in, and it's just gonna cook the whole bird really unevenly. By the time that interior stuffing reaches a safe temperature to eat it, you're left with an overcooked, unevenly cooked turkey and mushy stuffing in the middle, which is the whole difference between stuffing and dressing. Is it's the same thing, except one is stuffed in the bird, which is, in my opinion, the wrong thing to do, The other is baked on its own, so it gets texture, which is the proper way to eat stuffing, in my opinion. Number 7 is do not cook the bird based on time alone. I know there's lots of guides that say cook the bird this many minutes per pound of meat and that's gonna give you a perfect turkey. I would never cook based off of this because all birds are different, their masses, their structures are different, ovens are different, oven settings work differently, temperatures are off. It's just not a good idea. You really just want to use thermometer probes. Two of them if you can. One of them inserted straight into the deepest part of the breast. And a good way to do this is to go in, hit the breastbone, and then pull back a little bit so you know you're in the deepest part of the breast. Another one is gonna go into the thigh. And that's gonna allow you to monitor both parts of the turkey that require different internal donenesses. You're gonna wanna pull the breast at 155, and that's gonna carry over to like a nice 160, 165. And the legs at that time should be around 180, 190. And anything above there really works, but anything below there, you're really gonna run the risk of having tough dark meat and legs. And if you see that little stupid pop-up thermometer that's stuck in there that you got when you bought it, ignore it, leave it in there until you're ready to serve and carve the turkey. Following that will not give you a good turkey. My number 8 is to avoid basting. Cooking a big bird, it's exciting, right? It really kind of urges you to check on it all the time and give it peeks and all this stuff. But every time you open the door, it's just a problem for the bird. Really slows everything down. I don't really ever baste. I don't really think it does a huge difference. If you see like the skin drying out, I may turn the bird, I may add a little bit of fat to it and then get it back in. But if you do that, I want you to take the bird out of the oven, close the oven door, and if you want to baste it, you can baste it there. But don't go in keeping the oven door open and basting it that way. That's generally not a good idea. It's best to sort of let it do its own thing. Number 9 is a focus on having good timing. Timing is everything in the holidays. You're the host, and there's nothing worse than watching a host panic or freak out or just not have it together. So giving yourself enough timing and thinking about timing is important. Work backwards. If you wanna eat at 4 p.m. and say you think that a turkey's gonna cook in 4 hours, get the bird in no later than 10 a.m. By 2 o'clock, it'll be finished, and then you'll have time to let it rest and 2 hours to prepare the sides and get everything ready. Having extra time is better than rushing last minute. That's when the mistakes really come. And allows you to be part of the party without being tied to the kitchen. The whole point of the holidays is to have fun. So, you know, you don't really want to be stuck there. If you give yourself time, plenty of time to be part of the party. Sort of leads to my next point, which is letting it rest. We're cooking big birds on Thanksgiving. Those birds are massive. They have a lot of mass to them and they will stay hot for way longer than you think they will. 2 hours is not a problem to rest. I promise you, it's what we do. In the past when we've done huge birds, get it out 2 hours ahead, let it rest. Just don't let it rest covered. Otherwise, that's gonna steam that skin that you worked so hard to get. And if it does get, say, down to room temperature, you make the gravy last minute so that it's piping hot, so that pouring it onto anything is a way of reheating these things. My 11 is now that you've got everything done, the bird's perfect, you're ready to carve it, just don't carve it at the table. Go out there, present the bird to the table, show them how nice it is, how hard you worked on it, retreat back into the kitchen, and carve it, you know, behind closed doors, just not in front of everybody. Not to say that you might screw it up, but doing it behind closed doors, in case you have any issues, you're struggling with anything, you're not making a mess and getting things everywhere, just get it back in the kitchen, carve it up nicely, take your time with it, get it back onto a platter, and then present that platter to the table for everyone to enjoy. Your work is done. My 12th tip is making sure that you've done all of your work by planning ahead, and you can do so with my holiday plan of attack, which is linked down in the description below. It's a holiday plan that's got timelines, shopping lists, and exclusive content online that's gonna help you tackle the holidays stress-free. So if you're interested in that, click the link down in the description and go check out my holiday plan of attack, and make sure you never cook a bad turkey ever again. Don't forget, if you're a patron, like one of those people scrolling up on the screen right now, you get the plan of attack for free. So make sure you go over to the Patreon timeline, and there's a post in there with all the information on how to access it. Hope you guys found this video interesting. Hope it's helpful. Hope it helps all of you cook a better turkey. That's all that I have today. I'll see you next time. Until then, take care of yourself and go feed yourself.